Well, as we draw closer to the Passover this year and Days of Unleavened Bread, we think about all that these days mean for us, especially the Passover and what Christ did for us and how that is so paramount to what we're thinking about at this time, that we get our minds on Him and what His sacrifice was about and what it did for us and what we look forward to through that sacrifice. But all of God's Word is important for us, and there are things throughout God's Word that we are learning and studying about, and some things that we've gone through and read through the years over time and again, sometimes we take for granted. We kind of skip over things so we can get to the next part or read up on something else. But as we are putting out sin this year, or striving to put leaven out of our lives and get our minds ready for these days that are coming, we sometimes forget about the examples that God has given us in His Word about some of these things that relate to this. And we kind of take it for granted, again, that why did God put these things there? Why did God do such and such in the Bible? Before God took Israel out of Egypt, He allowed them to see His power and His strength over the gods of Egypt by destroying all of them. Today we're going to look at the account of the 10 plagues that God put over Egypt. And what did they represent? And what lessons can we learn from these things for us today in our life? What do they mean for us? Can we see things in there that we really need to know? Why did God bring these plagues on Israel? On Egypt at that time. Let's go first to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're going to begin in verse 1. I'm reading this from the NIV. 1 Corinthians 10, beginning in verse 1, Paul tells us here, "For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers, that our forefathers were all under the cloud, and they all passed through the sea. And they were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea." So that going through the sea was a type of their baptism, that they were leaving this world behind, leaving Egypt behind, and coming out and being baptized through that sea. And the waters then, of course, covered over them to give that example that we have of when we go through baptism. We've repented, we make a commitment to God that we're going to put away what this world has, and as we come out through the other side, He gives us His Spirit so that we can then do the things that we can't do on our own. Very important that we don't forget that. Verse 3 says, "They all ate the same spiritual food. They drank the same spiritual drink, for they all drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them. And that rock was Christ. We also, like them, brethren, eat of the same rock, Jesus Christ. He is what nourishes us. His Word that we read, that we eat at this time of the year especially, drinking in that Word now, digesting that bread of eternal life, how important it is for us. So like Israel, we are also eating of the same things together." Verse 5, "Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered through the desert." What was it that they had learned? Or what did not learn? Had they not learned from all the things that they saw and they experienced? How was it that God can say, after all that they'd been through, He was not pleased with them? What was wrong with them? Verse 6, he goes on and says, "Now these things occurred as an example to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did." Their problem was they set their hearts, their minds, their whole devotion was to want it to do what they wanted to do, not what God wanted for them. God took them out of Egypt. God brought them through incredible miracles right before their eyes, yet it says here, they set their hearts on evil things. We cannot set our hearts on anything except what God's Word shows us. And God gave Israel 10 commandments. Besides the 10 plagues that He gave them, He kind of countered them with 10 of His commandments. 10 things that they were to be doing to counter how they were living prior to their coming out of Egypt. Now let's turn to Exodus chapter 20. Let's look at that very first commandment. We're not going to go through all of these, but we're going to look at this first commandment briefly to see what it was that God wanted them to see that was so very important for them. Exodus 20, beginning in verse 1. It says, "And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." God is reminding Israel here, right from the very beginning of Him giving His commandments at Mount Sinai, He's reminding him first, right up front, that he is the one who took them out of the bondage that they were in. When they were crying out to God for help, when they were crying out for what they were being oppressed with, God says, I am the one who took you out of there. What has God done for us? The same thing. Just as Paul said here, the same thing. They drank the same drink. They ate from the same rock. We also had the same blessing that was given to them made available to us. We were taken out of the bondage of this world, from the God of this world that has had, you know, hold over us for all of our lives. From the beginning of man's time, when Adam and Eve ate from that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, we've been given over to the God of this world. Are we yielding to that God, or are we yielding to the God who says, I brought you out of bondage? Verse 3 says, and you shall have no other gods before me. See, they didn't understand this because they came out of an experience for a couple of hundred years that was teaching them about other gods. And God's reminding them now, first thing as he brings them his word, you shall have no other gods before me. He is the only God that we are to look to. There is no way that we continue to have other gods before the one true God, because God says they must all be destroyed. And that's what he did for Israel back in Egypt. Let's turn back to the account of God preparing Israel for their leaving Egypt. Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. And we're going to begin in verse 7. God here had appeared to Moses in the burning bush, and he gave him instruction of what he expected for him to do. Introducing himself in verse 6, he says, moreover, I am the God of your father, the God of Abram, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Could imagine that this is what was really happening to him right now, that he was being instructed by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You know, how is this? One thing to see this bush burning, but now God is speaking to me directly here. Verse 7, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land, large and flowing with milk and honey, unto a place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians have oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Brethren, we have been oppressed. We don't think about it like that much, do we? Israel was physically oppressed, and they really felt that. Do we really feel the oppression that's been going on in our lives over the years of being here on this earth? Have we seen that oppression? You know, we're living in a world that is so given to everything we want. All our desires are there. Everything to make us physically happy in this realm, we've got it here. Especially in this country, we can't even imagine how other people around the world are living, because we are so incredibly spoiled. But God says, I know their oppression. I've seen this oppression that they're going through. God has seen the oppression that has been corrupting the minds of people for 6,000 years. And he stepped down, and like he did with Moses in Israel, he has stepped down and also touched us, brethren, and taken us out of that. And we have to remember here, there's definitely a correlation between Israel, physical Israel, and spiritual Israel, as the church is known, as being the ones that God has also taken out of this oppression, mental oppression. And we don't even think about it. People are depressed, they're frustrated, their lives are in many ways broken down, their children aren't together. I mean, we can go on and on with the things that people have, yet they're so focused on all the physical, material things, they think they can hide that or cover it up. Yet they live out their lives really being miserable and don't even recognize where it's stemming from, what's coming, where it's all behind. Where did this all come from? It came from an oppressive authority that's been over man for all these years. Verse 10, he says, Come now, therefore, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. And Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh, and that I should bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt? God says to him, Certainly I will be with you, and this shall be a token unto you, that what I have sent you, when you are brought forth the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God upon this mountain. It's not Moses, brethren, that brought them out. It was God that brought them out. Moses was the physical instrument that God uses or used for them. And he uses physical instruments today, ministry that serve God's people. They're physical individuals, but inspired, hopefully, by God to lead people to God's way. That's the same commitment that God's ministry should have, as Moses had here, to do what God instructed him to do. Moses said to God, Behold, when I come to the children of Israel, and I'll say to them, God, the God of your fathers has sent me, and they'll say to me, What is his name? And that I will say unto them, I am God. And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, Thus shall you say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent you unto me. I am is the God who is eternal, who is all-powerful, the everlasting. He was from the beginning, he is, and he will always be. The self-existent and eternal God. The exact opposite of all the forms of idolatry that the human mind has conceived, whether it's animal, whether it's celestial, that has prevailed on this earth for 6,000 years. God says he is the complete opposite of that, and they don't know this yet. But you're going to tell them who I am. I am the one that is self-existent. This is not a false God. This is the God coming to you now, Israel. You haven't seen this yet. You've been here for a couple of hundred years. You've lost track of what's going on. Dropping down in verse 19, Exodus 3, he says, And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go. No, not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, and I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. He was giving Moses now a little heads up as to what you're going to expect. You know, I'm sending you down here. I'm going to give you instruction on what you're going to do. But this is the kind of response you're going to get. He's not going to be very quick to let you go. He let him know right up front. Exodus chapter 4, dropping down to verse 18. Again, God is revealing to Moses what to expect here. Verse 18, he says, And Moses went and he returned to Jethro, his father, and he said to him, Let me go, I pray you, and return to my brethren which are in Egypt, and see whether they're yet alive. And Jethro said to Moses, Go in peace. And the Lord said to Moses in Midian, Go, return to Egypt, for all the men that are dead that had sought your life. And Moses took his wife and his sons, and they set them on a donkey, and they returned to the land of Egypt. And Moses took the rod in his hand that God had given him and showed him what he was doing with that rod. And the Lord said to Moses, When you go to return to Egypt, see that you do all those wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in your hand, but I will harden his heart that he shall not let the people go. Verse 22, And you shall say to Pharaoh, Thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say unto you, Let my son go, that they may serve me. God was letting Pharaoh know here, as well as we read this, that Israel was considered his firstborn, the ones that were a type of what was coming later on. Jesus Christ is the first of the firstborn. Israel here is the firstborn of those physical individuals that God was working with as a nation at this time. He says, And I say unto you, Let my son go, that he may serve me. And if you refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay your son, even your firstborn. Again, God made it very clear right up front what the consequences for Pharaoh would be. He was telling him what the outcome would be. Moses knew before he went to see Pharaoh what God had in mind. Turn back to Amos chapter 3. Let's notice here what God tells us about giving instructions so that people are aware of and armed for that. Amos chapter 3 and in verse 3, God says here, Can two walk together except they are agreed? Now clearly Israel and Egypt should not have been walking together. At that time, there was confusion as to what God's rules, laws were, what their obligation was, and God had to come down and do something to show them. But can two walk together unless they be agreed? For will a lion roar in the forest when he has no prey? Will a young lion cry out in his den if he has taken nothing? Can a bird fall in a snare upon the earth where there is no snare for him? Shall one take up a snare from the earth and have taken nothing at all? Nothing at all? Shall a trumpet be blown in the city, and the people not be afraid? Shall there be evil or calamity in a city, and God has not done it or allowed it? Verse 7, surely the Lord will do nothing, but he reveals his secret to his servants, the prophets. So here we see, before Moses even went into Egypt, God was letting him know what his plan was. What's going to happen, Moses? You're going to go down there, you're going to give him a lot of instruction, you're going to tell him what I expect him to do. He's going to refuse. He's going to be very hard-hearted with this. And you're going to let him know that if he continues to be stubborn with this, his children, his firstborn, will die. The firstborn of Egypt will die along with his own. Turn over to John chapter 15. What Israel experienced, brethren, was for our learning, as Paul told us earlier, and to encourage us as to how we should be viewing our relationship with God. How do we view what we're doing? Are we like Israel, that we are wanting our own way and being stubborn in that sense? Or are we allowing God to lead us and direct us? Because he's given us everything we need to know. John 15, verse 14. Christ says here, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. Henceforth, I call you not servants, for the servant knows not what the Lord does, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known unto you. Just like God told Moses, look, here's what's going to happen. You're equipped, you know what's coming. And Christ says, look, I'm telling you as friends for us today. He's made known everything we need to know. Everything that the Father has revealed to him, Christ has shown us as well. Verse 16, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go forth and bring fruit, and that your fruit should remain. And whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. This is a promise that Christ gave us before he died, letting us know that we have as well this relationship where he can tell us what to expect and what he expects from us and what we should be doing. Let's go back to Exodus chapter 5. Exodus chapter 5 and beginning in verse 1. Exodus 5, verse 1, reading in the NIV, it says, afterwards, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh, and he said, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says, let my people go so that they may hold a festival to me in the desert. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, and I will not let Israel go. In essence, he was saying, not only do I not know God, I don't care for him. I don't care anything about him. I know nothing of him. And neither do I value or fear God. A total, arrogant, self-centered mannerism, inspired by one who was inspiring him as well. Israel was now a despised and oppressed people by this Pharaoh. Just like we, brethren, have been despised and oppressed by Satan the adversary in this world that we've been living in. With the same mentality that Pharaoh has, that he refuses to yield to God's direction. He's in charge, and he's going to set the guidelines and the rules. You will follow them. He could care less about their God. Just as Satan could care less about God, our God. So God was going to put these plagues on Egypt to let them know who he was. You don't know who I am? Well, I'm going to show you who I am. Now, these plagues were divided into three sets. If you look at this, when you go through it, you'll see that there are three pretty much distinct groups that they go through. And the first were concerning pain and discomfort. They had pain and discomfort with these plagues. Now, the first plague, God gave him a warning before the plague came. They were warned. Turn to Exodus chapter 7, and we're going to read through Exodus 7, this first plague that they were going through here. Exodus 7 and in verse 14. And the Lord said to Moses, Pharaoh's heart is unyielding. King James says hardened. His heart is hardened. He refuses to let the people go. Go to Pharaoh in the morning as he goes out to the water. Wait on the bank of the Nile to meet him, and take in your hand the staff that was changed into a snake. and then say to him, the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, has sent me to tell you, let my people go so that they may worship me in the desert. But until now, you have not listened. He was not listening to what Moses had told him prior. Verse 17, this is what the Lord says. By this you will know that I am the Lord. You know, you said before you didn't know God. You didn't care about him. You didn't care to know anything about him. But God says now, you will know that I am the Lord. And with the staff that's in my hand, I will strike the water of the Nile and it will be changed to blood. The fish in the Nile will die and the river will stink. The Egyptians will not be able to drink its water. The Lord said to Moses, tell Aaron, take your staff, stretch out your hand over the waters, over the streams and the canals, over the ponds and all the reservoirs, and they will be turned to blood. Blood will be everywhere in Egypt, even in the wooden buckets and the stone jars. You know, I love when you read some of these accounts of people who look at this and they say, oh, well, it was some kind of a thing that every year the river kind of turned pinkish. Okay, this is not pink. This is blood. The fish didn't die from pink river. They died from the blood that was in the water. The buckets didn't turn pink from the river. The buckets had blood in them that God turned everything that was water at that time to blood. People want to argue against what God says. And that's where the problems come in, when they don't want to obey and follow what God says. So Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded. He raised his staff in the presence of Pharaoh and his officials, and they struck the water of the Nile, and all the water was changed to blood. The fish in the Nile died, and the river smelled so bad that the Egyptians could not drink its water. Blood was everywhere in Egypt. But the Egyptian magicians did the same things in their secret arts. And Pharaoh's heart became hard, and he would not listen to Moses and Aaron, just as the Lord had said. See, Moses, Pharaoh, had a hard heart to begin with. You know, we don't see God even saying at this point that he hardened his heart. It says here that his heart was hard. He was a rebellious, arrogant, self-centered, self-righteous man who refused anything to do with God. Going on in verse 23, instead, he turned and went into his palace and did not even take this to heart. And all the Egyptians dug along the Nile to get a drink of water because they could not drink the water from the river. 7 days passed after the Lord had struck the Nile. Now, what was significant about the Nile was that the Nile was the lifeblood of Egypt. It was what gave them the food that they had. And when the Nile every year would overflow its banks and the silt would go out into the land, it would fertilize, it would give nourishment to the ground, and their crops would grow. It sustained them for life and for growth. Egypt would have been a desolate desert without the Nile running through it. So the Egyptians worshiped the Nile. It became a god to them. The Nile provided blessings and happiness for them. They were happy because they could eat. They weren't starving to death because of the Nile. And they even wrote hymns for the Nile, for their god Nile. The hymn started out, the Hymn of the Nile, it was called. It says, hail to you, O Nile, who manifest yourself over this land and comes to give life to Egypt. How ridiculous, how foolish to think that a river was what gave them life. Mysterious is your issuing forth from the darkness on this day wherein it is celebrated. They worshiped the Nile. It was their god. And they looked to it. And now it had turned to blood. And whenever their magicians tried, they did the same thing. They were able to turn water to blood as well. It's always interesting as you go through these accounts. They were doing what Moses did. They turned things to blood and they made things happen. But you would think they would have wanted to stop it from happening. No, they were showing in their ridiculous mentality that they could do the same thing. So it's no big deal. Well, you know, what God did, he turned into blood, we could do the same thing. You know, so is God really God? What was happening was the watering of the orchards was being created by what they felt was the god Ra, who caused the cattle to live and eat from that, you know, crops that would grow on the grass that would grow for them. And he gave them the water to drink. Today we have what we call Mother Earth. You know, people look to the world and they worship this ground. You know, they worship what is physical. They don't know what God is. How many things, brethren, as we go through these accounts, are we picking up from this world's ways of how they view what was going on back in Egypt? We think we've come so far from that. Oh, we don't worship the Nile. No, what do we worship that is around us? What things do we hold on to? Notice in Ezekiel 29, a prophecy that was given here by Ezekiel. Ezekiel 29, beginning in verse 2, says, "Son of man, set your face against Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and prophesy against him and against all of Egypt." Now, again, this is a prophecy for the future. This is talking not about the Pharaoh we read about, but there's a correlation to the attitude that is here. It says, "Speak against Pharaoh, king of Egypt." Verse 3, "Speak and say, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against you, Pharaoh, king of Egypt, the great dragon that lies in the midst of his rivers, which has said, my river is my own and I have made it for myself." Who's he talking about here? The Pharaoh he's talking about is not a physical man. He's talking about Satan. This is a future prophecy about the times we are coming up to very shortly, that the God of this world is the God of the Nile, is the one who thinks he is the God of this world and is ruining people's lives with his oppressive ways. He says, you're in the river. He says, you said that you've made for yourself. God says here, but I will put hooks in your jaws and I will cause the fish of your rivers to stick to your scales. I will bring you up out of the midst of your rivers and all the fish of the rivers shall stick to your scales. And I will leave you thrown in the wilderness, you and all the fish of your rivers, and you shall fall upon the open fields, and you shall not be brought together nor gathered. I have given you for meat to the beasts of the fields and to the fowls of heaven. Destruction is waiting for this creature. And all the inhabitants, verse 6, of Egypt shall know that I am the Lord. This is what God was trying to get across to Pharaoh when he was bringing these plagues to him, that he is the God. I am who I am. And he didn't understand that. And at the time of the end, God is going to reveal to this world as well, brethren, that he is the true God. Not some God with long hair, with, an effeminate look that really reflects the God of this world right now. No, the true God is going to come back and is going to take charge of things. And the inhabitants of Egypt shall know that I am the Lord, because they have been a staff of reed to the house of Israel. So God is using the example of Egypt in this prophecy. Egypt, again, is a type of the world and its inhabitants. The prophecy that we're looking at, again, is that talking about a ruler that is going to come just before Christ returns. He says he's going to put hooks in his jaws. We could go back and read in Job where God talks about putting hooks in Leviathan. And ask Job, can you draw out Leviathan? Can you control Satan, the devil? Well, God can, because he is God. And this is what Pharaoh didn't understand. Your God is under the control of the God of the universe. And he showed that he turned his God to blood, that there's nothing there. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 9, you don't have to turn there, but it says, "And the dragon that was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceives the whole world, he was cast out to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him." So we see here, one God has been destroyed by God, the God of the Nile, the God who represents the God that lives in the sea today, that we know as Satan. The second plague that he brought, Exodus chapter 8, beginning in verse 1, we'll read that. Exodus chapter 8. Exodus chapter 8 and verse 1, the second plague that we're going to see here is that of the frogs that were brought out. Exodus chapter 8 and verse 1, it says here, "The Lord spoke unto Moses, and go to Pharaoh and say unto him, thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me." Again here we see another warning. The second time that God is bringing a plague, he's preceding it with a warning to Pharaoh, giving him a chance to make a decision to do something, if he's smart enough. "Speak unto Moses, unto Pharaoh, God spoke to Moses and said, go to Pharaoh and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. And if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all the borders with frogs. And the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come down unto your houses, and unto your bedchamber, and unto your bed, and unto the houses of your servants, and upon your people, and unto your ovens, and into your kneading troughs, into everything. These little creeping things would be bouncing all over every place. And every time they turn around, there's something green hopping to the left, hopping to the right, hopping on them, on their food, on their tables. These little ugly little things that sound cute when we hear them in the woods, right? But how would you like billions of them running around? I'm sure it was deafening after a while to hear that many frogs croaking. Well, they didn't croak yet. They were just making noise at this point. Okay. And the frogs shall come upon you and all your people and upon your servants. And the Lord spoke to Moses and said to Aaron, stretch out your hand over the with the rod over the streams and over the rivers and over the ponds, and cause the frogs to come up out of the land. And Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. And the magicians did so with their enchantments, and they brought up more frogs. Isn't that great? And they didn't have only a couple of billion frogs. Now they had maybe 10 billion frogs to contend with. So for some strange reason, they like to bring more problems on themselves by showing how great they are. What vanity. What vanity there is in men's thinking that they are better and smarter than God, you know, to bring out even more of these little creatures. Verse 8, Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron and said, entreat the Lord that he may take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go that they may do sacrifice to the Lord. And Moses said to Pharaoh, glory over me when I shall entreat for you and for your servants and for your people to destroy the frogs from you and from your houses, that you may remain in, that they may remain in the rivers only. Now the frogs, he brought these frogs out, they were regarded as having divine power. The Egyptians worshipped, I think they had over 80 different gods that they worshipped. And these are just a few that God was isolating here. Some of them kind of overlapped with what they did. But these frogs had divine power. And the Egyptians, they had worshipped the goddess Heqet, H-E-Q-E-T. And she had the form of a woman with a frog's head. And from her nostrils, it was believed that came breath of life and animated the bodies of those that were created by her husband, the great god Khum. And from the dust of the earth, they came up, and the frogs were not to be killed. They couldn't kill the frogs. They let them live wherever they were because these were representing this goddess. And the Egyptians made the frog into a symbol then of the fetus. And it was represented by what we might know today as a fleur-de-lis. If you ever look at a fleur-de-lis, it has that kind of shape of the frogs. You know, if you look at it, you got to see it to really catch it. But a fleur-de-lis represents a frog. And to this day, they are making garments. Well, they made garments that were shaped like a fleur-de-lis because it was a frog. They actually had these designs so that it did that. Even in Rome, the frog was sacred to Venus, the goddess of love and fertility. And in Egypt, she was the goddess of birth. Again, frogs were not uncommon to Egypt, especially around the Nile. But there never had been so many as there were now. And only Moses then could take away the frogs. Moses gave Pharaoh an option of naming the time for the frogs to be removed. So Moses asked, in verse 10, he said, tomorrow, and he said, be it according to your word, that you may know that there is none like unto the Lord your God. And the frogs shall depart from you, and from your houses, and from your servants, and from your people, and they shall remain in the river. Even gave Pharaoh the opportunity to name the time that they would leave. So you'll know that God did this, because you're going to say when it's going to happen, and God will make it happen. Because I'm telling you now, God said, you name the time, and it will happen. Verse 12, and Moses and Aaron went out from Pharaoh, and Moses cried to the Lord because of the frogs which had been brought out against Pharaoh. And the Lord did according to the word of Moses, and the frogs died out of the houses and out of the villages and out of the fields. And they gathered them together upon heaps, and the land stunk. Millions and millions of stinking, smelly, rotting frogs. And they were looking to these frogs as gods. Something that rotted and died, that was supposed to bring life and fertility, God destroyed before their eyes. Egypt was now rid of the frogs through the death, which meant that the huge heaps that were piled up now became a stench to them. Now their god became a stench in their own nostrils. The gods of this world, brethren, the things that we have held on to, God says, should be a stench to us as well. We need to detest the idols, the things that we have looked to and held to that have kept us away from God, as things that should be a stench to us as well, because it is a stench to God. The third of these plagues that God brought was that of lice, dropping or continuing in verse 16. Now there's no warning here given. Verse 16 says, the Lord said to Moses, say to Aaron, stretch out your rod, smite the dust of the land, that it may become lice throughout all the land of Egypt. And they did so, and for Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and smote the dust of the earth, and it became lice. And all the dust of the land became lice throughout all the land of Egypt. And the magicians did so with their enchantments to bring forth lice, but they could not. For there was no lice upon man and upon beast. Now this one they couldn't do. Here's one of their miracles that God just did before their eyes that they couldn't do. They worshiped the insect god of Keper, or K-H-E-P-E-R, Keper. And it was, again, another insult to this god that they could not get rid of them. Or they could not bring them. They had no power whatsoever to deal with this god that they had. They could not produce the lice. They even tried to have Pharaoh see that this was God's hand in this. Verse 19, the magician said unto Pharaoh, this is the finger of God. And the Pharaoh's heart was hardened, and he hearkened not unto them as the Lord had said. He disregarded their words. Didn't want to hear what they had to say. They were telling him, look, this has got to be something here because, you know, we couldn't do this. We couldn't recreate this. And again, there was no warning on this one. This plague just came on them. God gave them two warnings, and then he said, no, this time you're just going to see my power. Which brings us now to the second set of these plagues that begin destruction over the land. Plague four was the flies. Beginning in Exodus chapter 8 and verse 20. Exodus 8 and verse 20. And this one now was another warning that God was going to give them. The Lord said to Moses, rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh, for he comes forth to the water, and say to him, thus says the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. Else if you will not let my people go, I will send swarms of flies upon you and upon your servants and upon your people and unto your houses, and the houses of the Egyptians shall be so full of swarms of flies, and also the ground where they are. And I will sever that day in the land of Goshen, in that which my people dwell, that no swarms of flies shall be there, to the end that you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth. God says, look, I'm going to bring these flies, but they're not going to go where Israel is. They're just going to be where you are. With these flies. He put a separation now between Egypt and Israel. Now the Egyptians worship the god Beelzebub, or called the god of dung, if you will. Good name for a fly god, because you ever notice where they kind of hang out? Yeah, right. So they liked that kind of stuff. So they were given, God gave them the name, the dung god. If you go back to 2 Kings chapter 1, there's an account there of King Ahaziah. When he was injured, we're not going to read that, but when he was injured, he sought help from Beelzebub, the Lord of the flies. And God asked him, is there no God in Israel that you have to go to seek the God of Ekron, the God of flies, for your help? Who do we turn to, brethren, when we're having troubles and problems in our life? We run to man, or do we go to God first? You know, God tells us in James chapter 5, whenever we're sick, whenever we're afflicted, call for the elders, and by the anointing of oil, laying on of hands, and the prayer of faith, God will intervene and heal us of our illnesses. God has promised us favor. He's promised that he will not bring the plagues of Egypt on us, or the diseases of Egypt on us, Psalm 103. So how are we or the blessings that he provides in Psalm 103. How are we looking to this world for anything? Or do we go to God? This Lord of the Flies was considered the patron deity of medicine. Now, if you're familiar with flies, and I wasn't as familiar with flies till we came down here where there's a lot of cows and chickens and dung. And boy, I tell you, sometimes it is terrible. I mean, the swarms and the garage is full of them. And you walk in the garage in the morning, you look at the ceiling and it's almost black with flies from yesterday or something. And when they die, they stink. I have put these little traps out to catch them, these little bags, and they go in there and then they fill up with the flies and they go to the back because it's away from the house. And I don't know what they got in it, but they like it and they go there and they die. And when you get the bag and you go to get rid of it, don't go near the bag. It stinks. These things are putrid. And God brought this God to show them how putrid their God is. You know, you've got a God that's a Lord of the Flies. Well, let me tell you, this God of yours stinks. The flies were so bothersome that Pharaoh was willing to negotiate with Moses to let the Israelites have time off to go worship their God, but only if they were to stay within the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh said they could go sacrifice, but not very far away. Again, brethren, Satan does not want to let go. There are times when we think we've made grounds with God and obeying him, and Satan says, no, come back. Don't go so far. You need to stay closer by. And the temptations are back again. And the problems are back again. And the things that we thought we had dealt with were gone. They're not. They're back again. Why? Because Satan does not give up. And neither did Pharaoh. He wanted to hold on. But God says, no, I'm going to destroy all these gods and show you who God is. And when the flies were all gone, after God released them from the flies, so was Pharaoh's motivation to let Israel go. That was gone as well. At one point, Pharaoh, in verse 28, even asked Moses to pray for him. What do we see here? He was showing his own self-centered interests. Wasn't concerned for the people, what they were going through. Concerned about what he wanted. So here were these stinking, disgusting flies representing Satan, representing the God, the healing God of this world, being destroyed. Notice in Psalm 119, what David tells us here, Psalm 119 and in verse 67. Psalm 119 and verse 67. David says, before I was afflicted, before I had any problems, health or whatever that he was going through, he says, I went astray, but now I have kept your word. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now, God, I keep your word. I know the difference now. Israel did not, Egypt did not understand that. They did not know God. But David says, look, before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I kept your word. You are good. You do good. Teach me your statutes. The proud will have forged a lie against me, but I will keep your precepts with my whole heart. Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in your law. That should be our attitude, brethren, that whatever trials we go through in this life, God is allowing them for growth. When I was afflicted, I went astray, but now I have kept your word. You know, God has brought us back. What are we doing in our lives? Verse 71, he says again, it is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn your statutes. The law of your mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver. Have we recognized the value of the God that has taken us out of bondage? Have we recognized the value of what he's brought to us that we cannot have to live this way in oppression? He's taken us out of that. Well, what do we want to do? What did Israel do? We're going to see what they did along the way. Plague number 5 was the murrain, or where the livestock was killed. Now, this was another one where they received a warning. And the 5th plague here was directed toward the livestock of the Egyptians. You know, something else that they worshiped along the way. Exodus 9, beginning in verse 1. It says, then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, this is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews, says, let my people go that they may worship me. Again, time after time after time, let my people go, and Satan will not release. Satan doesn't want to let us go. No matter how much, you know, the desire may be there. He wants to control what we are doing. Let my people go that they may worship me. If you refuse to let them go and continue to hold them back, the hand of the Lord will bring a terrible plague on your livestock in the field, on your houses and your donkeys and your camels and on your cattle and the sheep and the goats. Verse 4, but the Lord will make a distinction between the livestock of Israel and that of Egypt, so that their animal belongs to the Israelites, that no animals that belong to the Israelites will die. Brethren, there should be a distinction between God's people today and the world. You know, God is working with us. God has opened our minds to see things. God has brought us to the place of repentance, baptism, and receiving the Spirit. How are we reacting with that? Are we taking advantage of the fact that we're not under that oppressive rule of this adversary? We don't have to suffer like that. You know, unless we voluntarily go back to it, we are kept from that. Nothing that we've done, it's by the grace of God that it's happening, but we are kept from that. Verse 5, the Lord set a time and said, tomorrow the Lord will do this in the land. And the next day the Lord did it, and all the livestock of the Egyptians died, but not one animal belonging to the Israelites died. Pharaoh sent men to investigate and found that not even one of the animals of the Israelites had died. Yet his heart was unyielding and would not let the people go. Again, doesn't mention here that God did this. This is still Pharaoh's stubbornness that he had. It wasn't hard for God to have to harden Pharaoh's heart. He already had a stubborn, arrogant heart. He was already resisting God's way and God's truth. So God virtually wiped out all the cattle of the Egyptians. And that was a large part of their wealth that they had in terms of economic disaster. It was disastrous for them as well. And this was represented by the god Apis, or again, the god Ra, often depicted with the head of a cow. And of course, we know that the cow was the basis for the golden calf that Israel made. Let's go back there, Exodus chapter 34. Exodus chapter 34. Exodus 34, I'm sorry, Exodus 32, excuse me, Exodus 32. In verse 1, it says, the people saw that Moses delayed to come down from the mountain, and the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron, and they said, go up, make us gods that shall go before us. As for this Moses, this the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we don't know what has become of him. You notice already here, you know, this is just, they had just gotten to Sinai. God is giving them the Ten Commandments. Moses is up there, maybe taking a little longer than they would have liked this to go on. And now they're wondering, is he ever going to come down? Did he die? What happened to him? You know, why don't you make us gods, Moses, that can go before us? Because this man that brought us out, it was God that brought them out. Remember, we read that earlier? I'm the one that brought you out of the land of bondage. Not Moses. God did it. He was just a physical instrument that God used along the way. And they said, this man Moses, we don't know what's happened to him. And Aaron said to them, break off the golden earrings which are in your ears and of your wives and your sons and your daughters and bring them to me. And the people broke the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron, and he received them at their hand and fashioned it with a graving tool. And after he made it into a molten calf. And they said, these are the gods of O Israel which brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Here's the gods that took you out. This golden calf. The very thing that God destroyed back here in one of these plagues, they were now reproducing. What things are we reproducing in our life that God has destroyed? You know, I can look back and look at the church today and I think, well, you know, Christ is not very positive about what the church's attitude is today. And what do we see people doing? They keep recreating what God destroyed 20 plus years ago. He tore something apart and they want to keep reproducing what God destroyed. Let's make an exact replica of what that is. Isn't that what they were doing here, making a replica of what God destroyed back in Egypt? What do we want to do, reproduce what God's destroyed? You cannot do that. It's foolishness. It won't work. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And they rose up early in the morrow, and they offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up and played. What an attitude. God just took them out of the bondage that they were crying about, destroyed all of the gods that were there, and they're now reproducing one that God destroyed. Take them back. And gave that calf the credit for taking them out in the first place. So, of course, Moses came down and was very upset over what happened. But we see here, whenever we take our eyes off of God, which is what they were doing at that time, we revert back to the pulls of this world. We revert back. As soon as we take our focus off God, what is it? He is the number one thing. Exodus 20, verse 1. He is the one, the God that we are to look at and worship. There is no other. We start to doubt whether or not God's a part of our life. What does doubt come from? That's another tool of Satan, the devil. Another one of his wonderful things that he does to people, causes them to doubt God. Are we suffering with doubt? That whether or not God is working with us, whether or not God is present in our life, affecting how we live and what we're doing? Or we don't look for God. We're looking for some physical thing to make us satisfied. The next plague that he brought them, again, this one had no warning. So we had two plagues with warning, no warning. Then we had two more plagues with a warning, and now no warning again. The sixth plague, Exodus chapter 9. And beginning in verse 8, these were the plague of boils. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, take handfuls of soot from a furnace and have Moses toss it in the air in the presence of Pharaoh. And it will become dust over the whole land of Egypt, and festering boils will break out on men and animals throughout the land. So they took soot from a furnace and stood before Pharaoh, and Moses tossed it into the air, and festering boils broke out on men and animals. The magicians could not stand before Moses because of the boils that were on them and all the Egyptians. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart that he would not listen to Moses and Aaron, just as the Lord God had said. So now God hardened his heart even more than it was to resist obeying him. The Egyptians fearfully were aware of epidemics. They knew about these things. They worshipped Sekhmet, a lion-headed goddess with alleged power over disease, another one of their, medical gods. And they also worshipped Sunu, who was the pestilence god, and Isis, the god of healing, another one of their healing gods. And here were these priests or magicians, whatever you want to call them here. God used the term magicians, but they were probably the priests of Pharaoh. And they couldn't even come before Moses at this point because they were sick. Their God could not do anything for them. God was destroying one after the other of Egypt's gods right before their eyes. The magicians are only able to rid the land rid the land of the boils. They were so afflicted themselves, they couldn't get out of bed. They couldn't do anything themselves. As was the case with all the false gods and false teachers, Paul warns us today of the foolishness of those who profess God, but not the true God. Because there are people that are talking about God, but is it God or what is it? Notice 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Paul here is talking about last days and that people are going to be, with these horrible attitudes. But verse 5, he said, some will have a form of godliness, but denying God's power. They're denying God. So you can't have power. You can't have God if you deny God. What you have is a false God then. They have a form of godliness. But dropping down to verse 8, he says, just like Jannes and Jambres opposed Moses. Now these are as we understand it, that these are the two of the magicians that stood before Moses and Pharaoh. So just as Jannes and Jambres opposed or stood before Moses, so also these men oppose the truth. Men of depraved minds, who as far as the faith is concerned, are rejected. But they will not get very far because, notice, as in the case of those men, Jannes and Jambres, their folly will be clear to everyone as well. Everyone who has God's Spirit will see that foolishness. Can we see through that facade of the false teachers and false ministers and false prophets that are out there? Because that's what he's saying here. Like these two false magicians who were before Moses, Jannes and Jambres, people will know their faults and their errors. They'll know what they are. Hopefully, brethren, we using God's Spirit have that. Because God has given us a spirit of sound mind, not confusion, not doubt, not fear, of sound mind to know the truth of God. Prove all things. That's what we're told. Prove all things. Seek out those truths of God. The seventh plague was that of hail. Now again, this one was with another warning. Exodus chapter 9, verse 13. The Lord said to Moses, get up early in the morning, confront Pharaoh and say unto him, again, this is with a warning now, this is what the Lord, the God of the Hebrews says, let my people go that they may worship me. Or this time I will send the full force of my plagues against you and against your officials and your people, so that you may know that there is none like me in all the earth. For by now I could have stretched out my hand and struck you and your people with a plague, and I would have wiped you off the earth. But I have raised you up for this very purpose, that I might show you my power and my name, that mine might be proclaimed throughout all the earth. So again, God is letting us know here that he allowed them to go on at this point to learn the lessons, that God is the God and there is no other gods. Verse 17, he says, you will set yourself against my people, and you will not and will not let them go. Therefore, at this time tomorrow, I will send the worst hailstorm that has ever fallen in Egypt from the day it was founded till now. Verse 19, give an order now to bring forth your livestock, and everything you have in the field to a place of shelter. He's giving them a warning, a heads up on this. Look, you don't want your livestock to die. He says, you better get them in, because the hail is going to fall, and every man and animal that has been brought out, that has not been brought out, that stands out in the field, that they will die. And those officials of Pharaoh who feared the word of the Lord now hurried to bring their slaves and their livestock inside. You know, some of them were now smartening up. You know, they said, well, you know what, after all these things, maybe this Moses is right. Maybe this God, there's something going on here, but not Pharaoh. No, not Satan. He will never give in to God's way. But those who ignored the word of the Lord left their slaves and their livestock in the field. Then the Lord said to Moses, stretch your hand toward the sky so that the hail will fall over all Egypt, on men and animals and everything growing in the fields of Egypt. And when Moses stretched out his staff toward the sky, the Lord sent thunder and hail and lightning flashed down to the ground. Fire was coming on the ground, burning up everything that was outside, just as God said. Verse 24, and hail fell and lightning flashed back and forth, and it was the worst storm in all the land of Egypt since it had become a nation. And again, it fell everywhere except Goshen. God's people were again protected from these things. He acknowledged that he was wrong. Exodus 9, verse 29. Moses replied, when I have gone out of the city, I will spread out my hands in prayer to the Lord. And the thunder will stop and there will be no more hail. So you will know that the earth is the Lord's. Verse 30. But I know that you and your officials will not, or still do not fear the Lord. Moses said, look, you know, you've got a track record now. I know you do not fear God. And you're going to continue to be obstinate and stubborn in all this. And when Pharaoh saw that the rain and the hail and the thunder had stopped, he sinned again. He and his officials hardened their hearts. So Pharaoh's heart was hard, and he would not let the Israelites go, just as God said through Moses. Turn over to Hebrews chapter 10. One of the characteristics of those who resist God and give themselves to Satan is not fearing God. He brought that out here. You know, I know that you don't fear God. Anyone who does not fear God does not know God, brethren. Hebrews 10, verse 26, if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have rejected the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice is left for sin. But if only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think a man deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated the unholy thing unholy thing, the blood of the covenant that sanctified him, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who has said, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, and again, the Lord will judge his people. That word there, trodden down or trampled in the NIV, means to reject with disdain, to abhor, to loathe, to detest, to treat with contempt. This is the attitude that Satan has to God's word. And we're being told here in Hebrews that we cannot have this attitude. We can't trample the word of God. We have to fear the God of this universe in order to know him. Why didn't Pharaoh know God? Because he did not fear God. You can't fear God. I mean, you cannot know God if you don't fear him. Psalm 55 in verse 19, God shall hear and afflict them, even he that abides of old, because they have no changes, therefore they fear not God. If there are no changes going on in our life, if we're not taking seriously the admonition we have to be examining ourselves now, to be looking at ourselves, to see whether or not we are having the right attitude prior to the Feast of Passover, if we're not examining ourselves with the right attitude, there are not going to be changes in our life. It's because we may not be fearing God. We're not taking him seriously. If there are changes, according to this, we fear God. If there are no changes, then there's no fear of God in our lives. Are there fruits of repentance? If we fear God, there needs to be. Pharaoh didn't fear. Notice Proverbs 14, verse 26. Proverbs 14 and verse 26 says, he who fears the Lord has a secure fortress. For his children, it will be a refuge. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, turning a man from the snares of death. How do we keep from being destroyed by the things of this world and Satan? By having a fear of God. It's a fountain of life. So we're not consumed with doubt or worries. Rather, we're confident that God is involved in our lives. On every level of our lives, God is involved. The eighth plague was that of locusts. Another warning was given here, Exodus 10, beginning in verse 1. Exodus 10, and beginning in verse 1 here. The Lord said to Moses, go unto Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants, that I might show these my signs before him, and that you may tell in the ears of your son and of your son's son what things I have wrought in Egypt, and my signs which have been done among them, that you may know how I am the Lord. Again, are we teaching our children? Are we passing this along? Are we living it in our homes and in our lives so that our families see the sincerity in what we're doing? God has given us miracles in our lives, taking us out of this confusion world to understand his truth. Are we showing that evidence in our life and teaching our children? Verse 3, and Moses and Aaron came unto Pharaoh and said to him, thus says the Lord God of the Hebrews, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? Let my people go that they may serve me. Else, if you refuse to let my people go, tomorrow I will bring locusts unto your coasts, and they shall cover the face of the earth, that one cannot be able to see the earth, and they shall eat the residue of that which is escaped, which remains unto you from the hail, and that you may eat, and shall eat every tree which grows for you out of the field. And they shall fill your houses, and the houses of all your servants, and the houses of your Egyptians, which neither your fathers nor your fathers have seen since the day that they were upon the earth until today. And he turned himself and went out from Pharaoh. And Pharaoh's servants said unto him, how long shall this man be a snare unto us? Let the men go that they may serve the Lord their God. Don't you know yet that Egypt is destroyed? And now his own men were trying to reason with him that, you know, are you crazy what you're doing here? You know, don't you see that Egypt is pretty much destroyed up to this point? They were worshiping here the god Nut, N-U-T. Now, I mean, it's kind of funny when you think that their god was a nut, but, you know, the reality is, it is. It was the nut god that they could blame for this. It was a great mother god personifying the night sky. And sometimes she was a cow whose udder gave forth the Milky Way. I mean, it's amazing how they just took things and made them into gods and then worshiped them. And when the true God came to them and warned them about what was going to happen if you continue to be stubborn, rejection was there. So Pharaoh's own officials now were pleading with him to let them go. And you know, it was only not until recently, with the problems that are going on now in the Mideast, can we kind of see how leaders who are so stubborn that they defy reason, bordering on insanity, and insist on their own way. I mean, we see that going on today over in the Mideast. I mean, the things that they're doing to hold on to what? They're finished, they're done, they're overthrown, but yet they won't give up. And that's the same mentality that was going on here. They're warning him, they're telling him, look, this is not going to be good. We've got to get out of this. Verse 10 and 11, and he said to them, let the Lord be so with you as it will, and I will let you go, and your little ones, look to it, for evil is before you. Verse 11, not so, go now that are men, and serve the Lord, for that you did desire. And they were driven out from Pharaoh's presence. They were driven out. Verse 16, and Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron in haste, and he said, I have sinned against the Lord your God and against you. Now therefore forgive, I pray you, this my sin, this once, and entreat the Lord your God that he may take away from me this death only. And he went away from Pharaoh and entreated God. And the Lord turned a mighty hand, a mighty strong wind, which took away the locusts and cast them into the sea. And there remained not one locust upon the coast of Egypt. But again, the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he would not let the children of Israel go. Plague 9 was that of darkness. Again, this one, no warning. No warning. Exodus chapter 10 and verse 21. The Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand toward the sky so that darkness will spread over Egypt, darkness so that it can be felt. And Moses stretched out his hand toward the sky and total darkness covered all of Egypt for 3 days. No one could see anyone else or leave his place for 3 days. Yet all the Israelites had light in their places where they lived. I mean, have you been in somewhere where it was so dark you could see nothing at all? I've had that experience where I've gotten up, you know, maybe during the night, and there was no lights on outside, nothing going on in the house, and you could actually, like it says, you could feel the darkness. That's pretty scary when you have no idea where you're walking and where you're going, and you could be walking into a wall. We take for granted that blessing that we have of vision and eyesight. But here, Israel again, Egypt again, rejecting what God was doing, but yet God blessed Israel where they had light. They weren't in darkness. Then Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron and said, go worship the Lord, even your women, your children, go with you, only leave your flocks and your herds here. And Moses said, you must allow us to have sacrifices and burnt offerings to present to the Lord. Our livestock must go with us, not a hoof is to be left behind. We have to use some of them in the worshiping of the Lord our God. And until we get there, we will not know what we are to use to worship God. But the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he was not willing to let them go. And Pharaoh said to Moses, get out of my sight. Make sure you do not appear before me again. Because this day you will see my face, you will die. Verse 29, Moses said to him, just as you say, I will never appear before you again. So the ninth plague was that of darkness. It was so intense that it produced dread in their hearts. For 3 days, the Egyptians and the Israelites were confined to their homes. 3 days of darkness must have been a tremendous emotional and psychological effect on them. But no repentance and no change. Again, this plague of darkness struck at the heart of the Egyptian deities, the sun god Ra, of whom Pharaoh himself was representation. Ra at this time was providing sunlight, warmth, productivity, and other gods, including Horus, were associated with the sun. And again, this plague had no warning. The last plague that we're going to look at, of course, is that of the death of the firstborn. Now, before Moses left, he did proclaim one more plague because he wasn't going to come back again. So before he left, he gave them that one more plague that they were going to suffer. And Exodus 11 in verse 1, the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. And after that, he will let you go. And when he does, he will drive you out completely. Tell the people that men and women alike are to ask their neighbors for articles of silver and gold. And the Lord made the Egyptians favorably disposed toward the people. And Moses himself was highly regarded by Pharaoh's officials and by the people. So Moses said, this is what the Lord says. About midnight I will go throughout Egypt, and every firstborn son of Egypt will die, from the firstborn son of Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the firstborn son of the slave girl who was at the handmill, and all the firstborn of the cattle as well. There will be loud wailing throughout all of Egypt, worse than there has ever been or ever will be again. But among the Israelites, not a dog will bark at any man or animal. Then you will know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. All these officials of yours will come to me, bowing before me and saying, go, you and the people who follow you. After that, I will leave. And then Moses, hot with anger, had left Pharaoh after he gave him this last warning. Exodus 12, we go through that and we see the account here of God telling Israel what they were to do on that same evening. They were to take a lamb out on the 10th day. They were to hold it up until the 14th. And then verse 6, you were to keep it until the 14th, and all the community of Israel shall slaughter them at twilight. And then they'll take some of the blood and put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses where they eat the lambs. And that same night, they are to eat that meat roasted over the fire along with bitter herbs made of bread without yeast. And do not eat meat raw or cooked with water, but roasted over the fire, the head, the legs, and the parts. Don't leave any of it until morning. And if some of it is left till morning, you must burn it. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked in your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover, because you will be leaving. Be ready to go. On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all of the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. Verse 13, and the blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no destruction of plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. One thing that history and the record of Israel has shown is how easy it is to forget or not appreciate what has been done for us in our lives. When we came to the place of repentance and baptism and God called us out of this world and we were baptized, that blood of Christ was applied to us just like it was to Israel on their doorposts. They were protected from death, and so have we. We're not under that curse of death now because of the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 12. Paul says here, giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be a partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who has delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. We can't comprehend, brethren, how blessed we have been to come under this blood and have this freedom of grace applied to us. Hebrews 9 and verse 11. When Christ came as the high priest of the good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made, that is to say, not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered to the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. The blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God and cleanses us, our consciences, from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God. And for this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promise, eternal inheritance. Now that he has died as a ransom to set them free, the sins committed under the first or the old covenant. We're free from that, brethren. How thankful are we to God? Israel was not thankful. They went back and made a calf to go back. They went back and resurrected the things that God had destroyed so that they could go back to what they were comfortable with. Are we comfortable with the truth of God? Are we comfortable knowing that God has called us, sanctified us now, and given us an opportunity for salvation? Do we hate the gods of this world as much as God does? Hopefully we do. Deuteronomy 12 and verse 28, God tells us here, "Observe and hear the words which I command you, that it may go well with you and with the children after you. And when you, whenever you do those things that are right in the sight of the Lord your God, and when God will cut off the nations from before you, where you go to possess them, and you succeed them and dwell in their land." And we are in a land that is now occupied by this god of the world, and we are living there. He says, "Take heed to yourselves that you're not snared by following them, after that they are destroyed from before you, that you inquire not after their gods, saying, how do these nations serve their gods? Even so will I do likewise. You shall not do so to the Lord your God. For every abomination which the Lord hates have they done to their gods. Even their sons and their daughters have they burnt in the fire to their gods. What thing soever I command you, observe to do it, and you shall not add to it nor diminish from it." God, brethren, has given us his understanding, his plan of salvation. Are we appreciating that and living by it? We need to be careful that we're not sneaking back to the world in disobedience to God. We need to be careful that our attitude is one of obedience. This world that we're living in is serving a different God. James tells us in James 4, "From whence come fightings among you? Do they not come even from your lusts in your members? You lust and you have not. You kill and you desire to have and you cannot obtain. You fight, you war, and you have not because you don't ask. You ask and you don't receive because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your own lust, your own desires." Do we want things for ourselves only? Verse 4, "You adulterers and adulteresses, don't you know that the friendship of this world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you." In spite of however stubborn Satan was through Pharaoh, God tells us here that when we resist Satan, God says he will flee from us. "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." We purify our hearts by using the Spirit of God and using his word to cleanse ourselves by the blood of Christ, by the water that was provided through that shed blood that he gave us. The world today, brethren, does not know any more than Pharaoh did of who and what God is. And we are right now at the door of plagues that are coming on this world. You can go back and read Revelation 15 and 16, and you're going to see a number of plagues in there that are exactly what Egypt went through. We're on the doorstep of more plagues coming on this world. Are we going to go through those plagues? Are we going to survive them because God is protecting us the way he protected Israel, because of our obedience to his direction and his guidance in our lives? Let's close in Hebrews 13, verse 21. Hebrews 13, verse 21. "May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, he will equip you with everything good for his doing. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever." Because Jesus Christ and God the Father are the God, the only God of this universe that is there. The gods of this world were destroyed by God during the plagues of Egypt. Let's be sure that we're destroying the gods of our life, whatever they may be, whatever things we've held on to that we've left behind. Let's be sure that we're not resurrecting them and bringing them along. Let's be sure that we can approach this Passover year knowing the true God and what we've been forgiven along that way of our idolatry, and given the understanding from God to make real changes and realize what his sacrifice has done for us.